Hello everyone. So our topic of discussion for today is the memory systems. You know, so as per the stage model, we have three very important memory systems. We do have the sensory memory, we have the short-term memory, and we have the long-term memory. You know, if we come to see each of these systems, you know, the sensory memory, the short-term and the long-term memory, they have different features and of course they have different functions to perform. You know, so in today's recording, we'll be touching upon these three different kinds of memory systems, and also we'll be touching upon the control processes, the elaborative rehearsals, the maintenance rehearsals. How do they work in order to strengthen the storage capacity of the STM and the LTM? STM is the short-term memory, LTM is the long-term memory. So let's get going, you know, with the very first one, which is the sensory memory. So here we have the sensory memory. Let us understand what is sensory memory. So the incoming information, whatever information is coming in, has to firstly enter the sensory memory. Even though it's got a, you know, like a large capacity, but in terms of the duration, time duration, for how long can it actually hold on to the information? That's quite minimal, you know, it's less than a second actually. It can hold the information for less than a second. So whatever is coming in, you know, the sensory registers or the sensory memories, they can be in what form actually? Let us try and understand that, you know. So whatever is getting registered, in case of the sensory memory, if we come to see, it's actually like exact replica. It's the exact copy of the stimulus itself, you know. So that is why probably we have somehow experienced the visual after images, you know. So for instance, if you just look at a bulb, something that's actually being so impactful on our eyes, you know, and upon closing eyes, many a times we do feel the flashes, we do feel the trail of bulb still, or the light still being there, you know. So those are actually visual after images. And many a times, you know, even if our eyes are opened, we still can see some kind of flashes in front of our eyes, and we still feel that light is still there, even if it has stopped, even if it has ceased, we still do feel the flashes. So all that we experience, they're actually the visual after images. You know, the trail of light that sort of remains, you know, even after the bulb is switched off, you know. And many a times we do continue to hear the sound also, the reverberations of the sound, you know, even if the sound has stopped, it has ceased. So these are actually those echoic or the visual sensory registers. So of course, visuals are actually the iconic ones, you know. The iconic sensory registers are the visual ones, and of course the echoic are the auditory sensory registers. We do feel the after effects, you know, the visual after images, you know, and we do feel the sound still ringing, the reverberations of the sound. So they actually have a very, very short duration, you know. The capacity to hold on the information, the duration of that is quite short. It's less than a second. So that this is what actually comes in less than a second. We can just get to have the visual after images or the reverberations of the sound. That's all we can hold for less than a second, you know. So then of course we have the next, which is of course your short-term memory. So we'll actually get going to the slide. So here we have the short-term memory. So when we talk about the short-term memory, you know, like, it's actually that, you know, if we come to see, we don't really pay attention to everything that's coming into our brain, or so to say, to each and everything, the incoming information, whatever so is getting into our brain, we're not paying attention to everything. If we do that, you know, our brain is going to get overloaded. Our memory is going to literally blast, you know. We really can't overload our memory. We cannot overload our brain. So this is something that happens very naturally, that we don't tend to pay attention to everything, you know. So basically, we don't pay attention to all the information that sort of strikes on our senses. So the information that is in a way entering, or the information, so to say, that is being attended actually, which is actually entering, and we are actually paying attention to it, you know, that sort of enters the short-term memory. So from the sensory memory, the incoming information is, of course, firstly going to the sensory memory. Then wherever we're going to pay attention, you know, very selectively to whatever information from the sensory memory, that selected information is going to get into the STM, which is the short-term memory. Now, this short-term memory, again, it holds the information for a very brief period of, let's say, usually like 30 seconds or less than 30 seconds. And of course, if we want to hold the information for a little longer time, then we need to understand that we need to actually give it rehearsals. You know, we need to practice it. So about which we'll be understanding further as to how can I strengthen the storage capacity of STM. So I'll have to give it rehearsals, you know. So if I don't really rehearse it, the information that has come into the STM, I might just lose it, you know, within like or maybe in a period less than 30 seconds, you know. So but of course, so we need to understand that there is a difference between sensory memory and the short-term memory, because sensory memory is very, very fragile. You know, it can barely hold anything. You know, in STM, we still can hold information. You know, that's something we need to understand. So, of course, moving on, we have the long-term memory. So, here we go. So, here we have the slide for the long-term memory, which is the LTM. So the long-term memory, we come to see here, the duration limitations of STM, of course, we know that it does have the duration limitations. But when we talk about the LTM, you know, here it's got a vast, vast capacity. And you can say that it's like a permanent storehouse of all the information. You know, something that's probably been so recent and it's so fresh in our memory, all thanks to the LTM. And also sometimes, not just about the recent information, but even some events that took place years back, we still have them very fresh. So that's all because of the LTM. And once the information enters the LTM, which is the long-term memory, it can actually never be forgotten, you know, because here the information is getting encoded in a way that we're trying to get into the meaning. In terms of its meaning, the information is getting encoded. And because here associations are made, you know, and when the associations there, when you're trying to link the information to something already existing, so it makes the storage even better, you know. So about which, of course, we'll understand even more. So here, of course, we can say that at times, yeah, we don't really recall things the way we experienced. Sometimes it's a little difficult to recall also many events that probably took place years back. That probably happens, you know, because of the retrieval failure. We don't have enough retrieval cues, or so to say, hints to be able to actually recall what happened, you know. So, but the crux is that LTM does have, you know, a storage which we can say for lifetime, you know, and we do remember everything, whatever goes in here, we actually don't forget that. So that actually what happens in the long-term memory. So now we're going to go to the control processes. So here, we're going to come to the very first one, which is the maintenance rehearsal. So before we go to the maintenance rehearsal, it's very important to understand that, you know, control processes are there to sort of, you know, monitor the flow of information, you know, through various memory stores. So we do have four of these most important control processes. So one is, of course, selective attention. We have the maintenance rehearsals. We have chunking and we have the elaborative rehearsals. So these are four most important control processes. So of course, going back to, our information, which is flowing from the sensory memory to the short-term memory, as discussed, you know, the information that we're going to pay attention to, you know, selectively, that's called selective attention, that is going to enter, you know, from the sensory memory to the short-term memory, you know. And of course, the impressions that probably the sensory impressions or the information that have not really been attended to, you know, they will obviously fade away quickly. And something that we pay attention to will move on from or flow from the sensory memory to the short-term memory. Now, in the short-term memory, there is a very important control process, which is the maintenance rehearsal, which we can see right in front of us. Now, this is very important, you know, if you really want to retain the information in the short-term memory, you know. So if I want that information should be there for some time, you know, then we need to make use of this process, which is the maintenance rehearsal. You know, so when we talk about maintenance rehearsals, you know, they are actually maintaining the information through repetition, you know. And once the repetition is stopped, the information will get lost, you know. So, yeah, it's sort of a trying to, you know, more of a rote learning, you know, you're just trying to be at it. You know, and you're continuously giving it rehearsals. You're continuously giving it repetitions. Of course, we rehearse because of or through repetitions. We keep repeating and that's how we are able to rehearse a particular thing. So when I stop it, you know, of course, I'm going to lose on to the information. That's what is happening in maintenance rehearsal. It's just helping me to maintain the information for some time, you know. So, of course, there is but another important control process, which is the next one. And it is, of course, chunking. Very, very interesting. And this also somehow helps me to expand the capacity of short-term memory, you know. And so, for example, you've got a number, a long number to remember. And the best way to remember it that I can break it into smaller chunks, you know. And so I can break it into smaller chunks and maybe like make a little story to remember it in a better way. Or maybe try and make, you know, the first liners to remember it, you know. So I'll just tell you how. Suppose there's a number like 1947, 1949, 2004. So I'm going to make it into maybe three chunks, 1947, 1949, and 2004. And maybe I can remember them better with the help of one-liners, like maybe, you know, that it's a particular year. So let's say 1947 is the year when India became independent, you know. 1949 is the year when Indian constitution was adopted. And 2004 is the year when the tsunami had hit the coastal regions of India and Southeast Asian countries. So of course, we need to remember that chunking is a way of breaking the bigger number, you know, that probably can consist of so many numbers, a chain of numbers into chunks, smaller chunks. And I can take help of liners, one-liners, or maybe make my own little story to remember it better. Even if that's not required anyway, you know, even the smaller chunks, you know, alone can help me to break it and strengthen the storage capacity of short-term memory. Now, of course, moving on to the next one, which is the elaborative rehearsals. Here we have the elaborative rehearsals. Now, when we talk about elaborative rehearsals, this is one control process which is going to help me strengthen the information in a way that strengthen the storage capacity, you know, of the long-term memory, you know. So whenever the information has to go from the short-term to the long-term, I will have to give it elaborative rehearsals. So I am actually strengthening not just the information, of course, I'm strengthening the capacity, you know, the storage capacity of the information. So that's very important. So that is what is happening in elaborative rehearsals. You know, so what is happening here, that elaborative rehearsals, I am trying to connect, I am trying to link the new information to the already existing information. So the information is already present in my brain, in my storage system. You know, I'm trying to link the new information to the already existing information. So for instance, let me just give you an example. You know, here we have examples of elaborative rehearsals. Let's say, you know, I'm trying to, you know, like imagine a relationship that strengthens sort of the association between the material that needs to be learned, you know. So example, I'm trying to learn a new name by relating it to an emperor with the same name, you know. So I want to learn a new name and I'm just trying to link it with the name of the emperor, which is already there in my memory system. So I'm just trying to link the new information to the old one. So the information may be expanded to fit into an already existing logical framework. So for example, you'd want to learn the car number 2346. Maybe you can do this by considering the relationship 23 into 2 is equals to 46. So again, I'm trying to, you know, link the new information to something that's already existing in me, in my memory system. So I'm well versed with the multiplications, you know, and because I want to learn 2, 3, 4, 6, and I can just maybe make this little story that 23 into 2 is equals to 46. So I'm just trying to link the new information to the old information, you know. So one last important thing that I want to add here, of course, is that what is the difference between the elaborative rehearsals and the maintenance rehearsals? You know, maintenance rehearsal is what we might typically think of as a rehearsal. That is the straight repeating of information in order to memorize it. This may also be referred to as a rote rehearsal, which I just explained you. You know, and example of maintenance rehearsal can be when you repeat the digits of a phone number until we actually dial them. You know, many a times we keep repeating the digits. And rehearsal of the information you're trying to learn, it can be mental, where you're thinking about and repeating the information in your mind, you know, or even it can be verbal, when you're just speaking and repeating the information loud. So that is what is happening in maintenance rehearsal. Mentally also, maybe you're trying to rehearse, or maybe verbally. So that is what is the difference between maintenance and elaborative rehearsals. So with this, we come to an end. Thank you so much.